Now it's your time. Please. Any questions? और एक बारे मछली किसको भी छापे कल एंड द प्रेस प्लीज मिस्टर रहमान वेरी एरुडाइट आई वुड हैव मिस्ड आई वुड हैव बीन एट अ लॉस हैड आई नॉट अटेंडेड दिस सेमिनार टुडे फ्रॉम बोथ साइड्स एंड द पुअर इंडियन मेल मुस्लिम दो शादी कर नहीं सकता पकड़ा जाएगा मीडिया में हाईलाइट हो जाएगा तो उसका सोल्यूशन क्या है धर्मेंद्र बन जाओ हेमा मालिनी से कर लो फिर कोई लॉ नहीं है वहां कोई क्रिमिनल ऑफेंस नहीं है कुछ नहीं है इसी तरह मजबूर किया जाता है कि आप कानून की खिलाफ वर्जी कीजिए पॉलीगैमी 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 वहां पॉलीगैमी हो जाए झूठा मुसलमान बन जाओ दोनों मुसलमान बन जाओ उसके बाद फिर जो करना वो करना है मगर अगर मुसलमान रह के कर लो तो बहुत खराब है और हम इतने अपोलोजेटिक हो गए हैं कि अगर कोई दूसरे निकाह करता है तो उसके सरकमस्टेंस को नहीं समझकर पहले फतवा देते हैं इसलिए आजकल तो फतवा मोदी की दुकान में मिल रहा है जो चाहता फतवा देता जो मुफ्ती नहीं वो लिखता मुफ्ती है फतवे के माने क्या है तलाक के माने क्या है पॉलीगैमी के माने क्या है किस लिए आया क्या वजह थी आयत क्यों उतरी तावील क्या है तंजील क्या है ये सब नहीं पता है हम आधा जानेंगे पूरा दिखाएंगे योर क्वेश्चंस प्लीज
आई एम मारिया शकील आई वर्क विद सीएनएन न्यूज 18 माय क्वेश्चन टू बोथ द पैनलिस्ट्स इज दिस दैट यू सेड दैट मीडिया टुडे इज अ प्राइमरी पार्टिसिपेंट इन द एंटायर डिस्कोर्स When, say, the BJP, during the course of the Uttar Pradesh elections, the law minister there had said that this is the stand of the BJP. They are looking at the issue of triple talaq from the prism of gender justice. What really stopped other political parties to also make their stands clear? When it is, if they have made it politics, if they have made this issue in the realm of politics, then why not others should try and maybe bring out that this is there should be no politics over it. For the last 2 months, this entire discourse started in the month of October, November. I was covering the UP elections at that time. What stopped other political parties? What stopped intellectuals? What stopped thinkers to come up and say that if a particular party is talking about it from the prism of gender justice, why shouldn't others make their stands known?
You asking me? You want to respond? Excuse me, madam, you're addressing the wrong people because we are not political parties. You must address your question to the concerned political parties and that is the right forum. My answer, I am not the person. As far as I'm concerned, I have written consistently right from the Prakash versus Pulvati case and what happened there, Justice Anil Dave and Goyal and what they did. That time I wrote, I have an article in EPW, I think, or my Asian Age column. I've consistently written, I write every month or every week. My question to you is that, to you as a media person, in April or May 2015, BMMA released their report of a study done in 2013. The study had 84 questions. 42 about exactly, are you married, are you divorced, did you get maintenance, did you get property right, lots of questions. Other 84, other half were just perspective questions. Do you think the triple talaq should be banned? Do you think polygamy should be banned? If a couple doesn't have children, can the man remarry? Can the man marry widow, etc. Not a single question, are you in a polygamous marriage? Now this study was done, BMMA is an NGO. And Zakir Soman is an ActionAid top brass official. Okay, ActionAid is a funding agency. Now ActionAid gives funding. Okay, to various organizations, Muslim organization. And one of the things is that their beneficiaries must be members of BMMA. So you get a 1 lakh membership, you don't know who they are, their names are not there, nothing, you don't be a 1 lakh. But study was not 1 lakh. Study was only 4710 of the people they work with, the communities. Now if I give a lecture and if I ask a question, or what I said, you will agree, haan mein haan toh mila hi denge na. I had this press statement that 92% of Muslim women want triple talaq to be banned. And 92% want polygamy to be banned, that Muslim women. Next day, and for the months following, before Prakash versus Fulbari, every newspaper worth its name, every journalist worth its name felt it is necessary to write about it. There was no question about what is this research. Let us look at the research. No time for journalists. Oh, quickly, by tomorrow I have to publish this story. And quickly, oh, Muslim women, okay, I'll write for Muslim women, I'll write for Muslim women. Everybody wrote, oh, Muslim women want this, Muslim women want this. So from 4710, it became 1 lakh Muslim women wants it. Very soon it became Muslim women in India want it. Okay? And that is why some lawyers, when Prakash versus, it was in the months immediately preceding Prakash versus Fulbari. I'm so happy you asked this question. Yeah, I'm so happy as a media person you are asking this question. So, when it's unheard of in the history that some other case is going on and the lawyers are just quizzing, are you are hearing Hindu women case, but what about Muslim women? Muslim women have no rights. Why? No, we have read this article, we have read this article. Oh yeah, Muslim women have no rights. Let us constitute a bench. I will make a reference to the Chief Justice. Unheard of in judicial history.
The bench. PL was filed on the basis of two articles in the media.
Two articles in the media, only the study only, but there were many more articles. Many more articles were there in the press. Everybody knew. Oh, BMA made this study that Muslim women want to build to be banned. Why did you create this? They had, their questions were 84. Why did you not ask, what are they asking? When was the study done? Which community? Where? Why did you not look into it?
There will be another fact which we need
Having
to...
Having that poster, Rukmini, S. Rukmini wrote about it, it's the first article that came. Faizan Mustafa's question is, that was much later, no journalist bothered to listen because this is what we want to hear, this is the sensationalism we create, we're very happy creating this Muslim bashing, and you're part of that process. I'm very happy. Why you go to UP elections? You go here, we even study, that is when the issue starts. Before Prakash versus
Fulbari. My question would be to the BMMA, of course you studied for...
You would ask her, she's asking the question.
No, of course, I'm not asking Maria. I asked this to Zakia Soman too. See, you claim 70,000 membership, okay? 70,000 membership. Obviously, it is an organization which is a women's organization, Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan. So obviously the members can't be men. So they are women. So my question is, when you had 70,000 members yourselves across India, why did you interview just 4,710? So, and you've had a bigger sample within yourself. So and I have seen their meetings in the media, not 10 people turn out in the meetings. So they highlighted something which was a non-issue, and now today it hogs the national limelight. There are I'm repeating once again, triple talaq is wrong, polygamy is wrong. I mean, Muslim men don't have the right to practice polygamy. I say that, but these are not issues facing the Muslims today. They are non-issues. It's very small issues. The bigger issue is illiteracy. 48.1% Muslim women are illiterate according to the 2011 census. Who is talking about it? For God's sake. But when will BMMA being a Muslim, Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan, talk about 48% illiteracy among Muslim women?
But Faizan, don't you think that the onus is on the community also to not let others hijack the debate? The rules of engagement have to change. Why is it that certain sections from the community are talking about issues? Others are deciding the discourse.
I
have a question, please.
Sorry.
I endorse Maria Shetty's view.
What's your contribution personally?
What do you mean? No, that is myself. So of course, he always raised the voice.
17 I have a layman's question to both the distinguished speakers. That is, How many personal laws are there in India, including the tribals and South Indian Hindus?
And this is
the
last question, I'm sorry, but this is
that whenever we read about triple talaq in the media, it is always highlighted that in most Muslim majority countries, triple talaq has been banned. I want to know from my distinguished speakers why it is so and why do you think differently in India? And my next question is, since you talked about so many, I'm taking the cue from our Honorable Mr. Imran's question, that a solution always, so many types of personal laws in so many different communities, castes and religion in our country, why can't we think of uniform civil code then?
For the last question of the last brother who has just immediately asked the question, in my days of standard 11-12, we had a chapter named Benaras of Aldous Huxley. He said in that chapter that for India, religion is something sometimes seems to be a luxury. And at that stage, with the Thara proposal in the year 1994, the courts of India has proposed for the fast track courts, as there are so many multiplicity of litigations and so many things which yet India has to decide, and they have not to having that time to afford for luxurious proceedings. And in that stage, when the domestic violence and these types of family courts and family problems are there, the decisions are not coming at this stage. The triple talaq issue itself is mitigating the problems. Then why should we go for the multiplicity proceedings? I feel that the
Only one small question. Like, I've been told that triple talaq is not found in Holy Quran. So I just wanted to know the historical, Islamic historical background, from where this has come out. Triple talaq.
Can you
feel
about I think I will answer the uniform civil code question and the triple talaq question. The other two questions I've forgotten what you asked. About personal laws, of course there are too many personal laws in India. Yeah, there are too many personal laws in India. I mean, with tribals, Hindus. Even in the Hindu law is not the same. The Hindu Marriage Act 1955, most of us not aware, is not uniform throughout India, first of all. Where is the question of uniform civil code? The Hindu Marriage Act has undergone two amendments, one in Tamil Nadu in my state and my neighboring state, Pondicherry. They say that as per the Hindu Marriage Act, without the ceremonies, Hindu ceremonies, the marriage is invalid according to the Hindu Marriage Act. Periyar of Tamil Nadu, who ran a reform movement in 1960s, he said that we do not believe, we are not Hindus, we don't believe in any, we are Hindus, but we don't believe in any rituals. So we should have something for us. We will marry in a non-ritualistic way. We must have something for us. So therefore, marriage by garlanding, marriage by exchanging of rings was allowed. And Hindu marriages were amended in 1967 in Tamil Nadu. Today it exists. So when there can be no uniformity in the Hindu law itself, where is the question of uniform Hindu code, uniform civil code? It's impossible. And then the people who talk about uniform civil code, they say that the best elements of all the religions will be taken and uniform code will be followed. So how is it possible? Will you adopt, she said, Islamic the law of marriage is the best, it's a contract. Now, will the Hindus accept as marriage as a contract? Then Islamic, there is a divorce procedure. Will the Hindus accept, or will the Sikhs accept, or will the Christian procedure be acceptable to a Hindu? So a uniform civil code in India is not just impractical, but impracticable. It's not possible at all. So therefore, and about his question on triple divorce. See, I have explained in my article, which now the board has come around to. I have listed about 7 steps from the Quran. How this marriage has to be, marriage can be broken. And this is the Quranic procedure. But unfortunately, what had happened was, under the Hanafi law, the Hanafis believe in triple talaq. Because they have, for some reason, completely gone outside the Quran. And to avoid this halala procedure, you know, it is basically for halala. They say that, although saying 3 divorces in one sitting is wrong, just like firing an arrow or firing a bullet, although like firing a bullet is wrong, but once the bullet is fired, the man is dead. You can't make the man live again. You can't retrieve, rejuvenate him. Similarly, although triple talaq is wrong, but once it has been said, it is legally binding. There is no evidence for this anywhere in the Quran. So actually, it is a problem of the Hanafi law, not of the Quran. It came in during the Hanafi period in India. And it has no Quranic basis. Quran lists seven steps. To give you briefly, the first four steps are nothing but reconciliation. The only after this reconciliation attempts have failed, as a fifth step, a person is allowed to pronounce first talaq. And after pronouncing the first talaq, there is a waiting period called idda, which is 3 months or three menstrual cycles. So within this period of idda, a person, according to, I'm quoting you entirely from the Quran, within this period of idda, a person can pronounce maximum of two divorces. And if the idda period lapses and he had not pronounced even one divorce, then the period lapses, then after the period of idda, he has just two options. Either to recontract the same marriage, to marry her again, and then live as husband and wife, or to pronounce the final divorce and separate. There is no other option in Islam. So this procedure, of course, since there is a lack of time now, I can't go into detail. And these eight or the seven steps would take up to a year to do, actually. So it is not overnight. So overnight pronouncing three words does not dissolve the marriage according to the Quran.
I want to answer the 20 countries question. What we are not understanding when we say 20 countries, we have to understand the majority-minority politics. Now, Pakistan is a majority Muslim-majority country. Indonesia, many of the countries, Morocco, Tunisia, Turkey, etc., Muslim-majority countries, then the religion of the state and the state merges. And it's very easy, Bangladesh, Pakistan, easier. But when it is minority, whoever, it's Christian minority, Muslim minority, and the state decides for them. Now, if you see the history of the personal laws throughout, why do we have a word personal? When the Britishers did criminal law, they refrained from entering the realm of the personal, which includes things like temple worship, or Muslim property, Darga property, various things are there, including Sabarimala and various other issues are there. How the temple has to be run, how the mat has to be run, etc. These are how your religious rituals are there. Now these are also protected, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 1, culture, your religion, your culture, you have a protection. So the Britishers also felt that we, after the Sipahi Mutiny, if you see, and that where the grease of the cow and the pig was used, and there were riots in the country, and the Queen's proclamation of 1858 that we will not interfere with your personal beliefs and personal practices. So when all the other laws got reformed, he said Muslim law, but it was applicable to all other laws as well, Parsi law, everybody. Unless the community came forward for a change, we will not impose a change. So now the issue is today, when the Christian law, it was very difficult for Christians to have the right to divorce on the ground of cruelty alone. Finally, it came in 2001. We had to get all other churches agreed. We have 64 Christian denominations. Only the Roman Catholic Church was opposing. And they said, you exclude us, you put it for everybody else. But we said, no, it is the Roman Catholic women who are suffering. So finally, Roman Catholic Church had to agree, and only the law could be amended. So this is the personal law. Now, if the Muslim community believes that board has the authority, or if there's a parallel authority, like you said, all of us come together, educated Muslim, create an authority where the community accepts you as an authority. That is very important. If the community does not accept you as an authority, it becomes very difficult. So why today the pressure is that board must change, board must put out. Now board has put out this five-point procedure because they are the ones who are giving the Friday sermon. They are the ones who are there reaching out to the community. Community believes this. So if the community believes that after the talaq, if I stay with my husband, it is haram for me. It's haram for me that I cannot, he believes it is haram, she believes it is haram, community believes it is haram, law says no, it is not haram. Will she go there? She will not go. Because this is a belief, because she wants to be a Muslim. It is the same thing about the Shabanu case. Finally, she got maintenance. And if a board said, no, this is haram, you cannot take.
I will just intervene here. I have this fatwa with me here.
exactly what happened. What is in the Muslim mindset, you know? The Muslims believe that the once this Maulvi say from the Muslim person about Deoband that triple talaq is correct, it is legal, they simply believe that. Recently, a lady came to our forum. I won't name her because of privacy purposes. And she said that I have been triple divorced by my husband and I want you to help us in some way. And she was a Hanafi lady, her husband had divorced her and all the Maulvis had told her that it is triple divorce case. I mean, you are a stranger to your husband, you can't go back and live without you undergoing halala. That is, you marry somebody else and he sleeps with you overnight and he divorces you next morning and then you can remarry your husband. It's an abhorrent thing which is completely un-Islamic. But she had no other, when she left the husband also wanted her back. And no Hanafi Maulvi was willing to issue any fatwa that marriage is not broken. So I spoke to the Ahlathis group, which does not believe in what you call this triple divorce. So I told the husband that, you know, see, if you agree, if I get you a fatwa from any Islamic seminary that this marriage has not broken, would you go back and start living with your wife? He said, yes, if you get me that, I will do that. So I wrote to I made that wife write to the Ahlathis seminary in Tamil Nadu. On this is the fatwa. On this side is the letter of that lady in Urdu, and the back side is the fatwa. Normally, fatwas are given like that, on the same page. This fatwa clearly says that the triple divorce given by her husband is un-Islamic, and it has not broken the marriage, and they may continue living as husband and wife. And seeing this fatwa, this only a photocopy, and he has the original with him. They now united, and now they are living as husband and wife. So this is the only, because it is in the mindset, it is in the mind. Unless the Maulvi says, they will not believe. So no matter how many intellectuals, Muslim intellectuals join together and form a forum and say, you are clean-shaven people. And Flavia is not even a Muslim, as she said. So therefore, nobody would trust us. They want some kind of a diktat from a person who has a long beard and wears that kind of a Islamic attire, so-called. So therefore, it is the only option open before us to talk to these people and make them change. This is the internal matter of the community. We have been doing, and I won't tell you what we have been doing. And you have seen the result recently. The Muslim Personal Law Board has come out with the 8-step procedure. That is a result of what we have been working from behind the scenes.
I just want to add here, like for instance, Pakistan has a marriage council. So you go before the council,
arbitration
council, and you go before it, you have to apply there. Now supposing here the government sets arbitrary council for the Muslims. Muslims will not accept it, but Muslims will not go, they still go for the Darul Qazas. So what is to be done? So unless it comes from that chain, BMMA can say anything, Podi can say anything, but the community has to accept it because you're doing it for them, you're not doing it for yourself. Even if liberated people like me get married under Special Marriage Act, who is asking you to get married under Muslim law because you're not a believer? You're outside the community. You can do that. You have a choice. Religion is not compulsory, but you choose that religion. You're born into the religion, you continue in the religion, you are a believer. So you cannot be outside of the religion, and this is the problem that we are facing. So it is no use bashing the board and say they are ignorant. Then you create something alternative, no, which people accept, but you have not been able to create that, unfortunately. Similarly for the Roman Catholic Church, we have not been able to create that. So you have to go through the same channel, never mind how progressive you are, how great you are. It really doesn't matter. Okay.
Thank you so much. It's extremely rude of me to interject this very lively and a very dynamic discussion, but I'm sure we can, you know, proceed with it during lunch because our other esteemed speakers are waiting. So I really thank Mr. A. Faizur Rahman, Ms. Ravia Agnes, and Mr. Sayyed Shahid Imam for engaging us in this very much needed deliberation. Thank you so much for enlightening us all. I'm sure some of my personal misconceptions have been cleared. We have a long way to go, but I'm sure, you know, it can only happen through negotiations like this. We don't need to close our doors to each other. And when you talk about something, just a kind of an addition, you know, of something like uniform civil code, I feel it goes against the essence of a multicultural, pluralistic society country that India is. So we need to preserve that essence, you know, what India has always been unique for, unity in diversity, that needs to be upheld. Thank you so much.